Welcome to Fox Valley in Focus. I'm Barb Nadeau. On today's show, we're going to talk about three local events. Rich Healy, the director of the Plano Area Chamber of Commerce, is going to talk about this year's Rockin' Christmas in Plano. Lane Allen is here from the Aurora Rotary to talk about the Aurora Festival of Lights. And Jessica and Ben Diven will be here to talk about Yorkville's Chili Chase 5K Run Walk. It's going to be a great show. Stay tuned. We'll be right back. Whatever we deny or
embrace for worse or for better. Underneath everything we are all people. And when we reach out a hand to one, we can influence the condition of all. That's what it means to live united.
Our first guest today is Rich Healy. He's the president and CEO of Plano Area Chamber of Commerce. Rich, thanks for being here to talk about Rockin' Christmas.
Well, thank you for having me.
It's something that you do the first weekend of December every year. And I remember the beginnings of Rockin' Christmas with stone soup and rocking chairs, but it's come a long way. So tell us a little bit about how this program got started and where it is today.
Well, actually, Rockin' Christmas began in the office of then-Mayor Bill Roberts. And he and some of the city staff were just sitting around talking about ways that they could help families in Plano. And they were tossing out ideas. And what evolved was the first Rockin' Christmas. It's rather ironic how they came up with the name Rockin' Christmas. People misconstrue what that stands for. They think rock and roll, they think a lot of different things, but actually the rock concept came from the rock that sits in front of the historic train depot is dedicated to Harry Newport, who was a longtime Plano resident, one-time mayor, and was considered the clown prince of Plano because in parades he always was out as dressed up as a clown. And so they sort of wrap that around a holiday activity.
But he was not just a clown. He was a very gentle and loving soul.
Yes.
Who endeared himself to the community.
Which, and Harry's spirit really exemplified the spirit that we like to capture with Rockin' Christmas. And that's the spirit of giving all year round. But we focus on the first weekend in December to culminate the activities for the year. And so the evolution of that has gone to rocking chairs, where we were out in front of the depot all night long, rocking, collecting canned goods and cash donations. And the purpose for all of that was basically to provide some holiday cheer to families in need during the holiday season.
You know, it's just a really sweet story. And how do you create an event out of nothing? And the fact that the people of Plano took a rock and turned it into what it is today is pretty amazing, because that rock and that spirit of one man who's remembered in that rock has now become so much more. And as you said, you know, going from rocking chairs and just doing a vigil for the needy, you know, rocking as a vigil overnight for the needy, to now you are distributing food to a lot of people.
Yes, last year we were able to provide food boxes to over 300 families.
Really?
And each year we, you know, it's one of those mixed feelings. You'd like to see that number decrease because you'd like to see people not in need, but we know that they're out there. But what we discovered last year was the fact that we were able to serve more seniors and more families who have children who are not school age. Before, in past years, there were a significant number of families with children, school age children, who were in need. That number has decreased, and we're happy to see that as the economy improves, their life at the home has improved. So that number's decreased, but that allows us to reach out to two other segments of the population that we've not been able to reach in previous years, and that's the families who have children that are not school age, and then our senior population.
How do you identify them?
We get a list from the school district for those that have in-school children, and we take the names and addresses off of the free and reduced lunch program list. The others, we rely on local churches to provide us with that information. We reach out to senior service areas that have names of seniors that may have not surfaced any other place, and we gather that together. Then we look at how much food we gathered and how much money we've been able to take in, and that determines the ultimate number of food boxes that we can put together.
Now, the event is going to be the weekend of December 4th, 5th, and 6th.
That's
it starts
correct.
On Friday night with the traditional rocking in front of the depot, right?
Yes.
And so how does the weekend progress? Tell us step by step what happens culminating with the 6th of December.
Friday night is really the activity night. That's when we kick everything off. The mayor throws a switch and lights the Christmas tree. We have a visit with Santa at the public library. The middle school band and the Emily G. John band come and play Christmas carols, weather permitting. And the downtown stores are open so people can go. They have open houses. So it's more of a festive type of thing. Last year we tried a parade, and we're going to expand on that this year. So we're going to have a parade as part of the element of Rockin' Christmas.
Is that going to be Friday night?
That'll be Friday night.
That'll be nice.
And that'll
in the dusk and
yeah.
evening hours. It'll be beautiful.
And so that basically will kick off the evening's activities. The crowning point of Friday night, though, is the awarding of the Spirit Award. This is literally an engraved rock that we present to an individual or a group of individuals in the community who exemplify the spirit of giving of the holidays all year long. Last year, our recipient was Tom Zimmerman, who is the head of Tommy's Gift. Mm-hmm. And in the past, we've had a number of recipients who have received that. And that really is, again, sort of tying all the festivities together into the more meaningful purpose of Rockin' Christmas.
What happens on Saturday and then on Sunday?
Well, on weeks leading up to the event, we're constantly collecting non-perishable food items and monetary donations. And then usually on Thursday or Friday before, or Thursday before and then Friday of the event, we take the monetary money and we purchase the perishable items, the turkeys, hams, milk, butter. And then on Friday night, we begin sorting all the canned goods and non-perishables. We need volunteers for that. We go down to Centennial School to do that. Then Saturday morning, we have coffee with the mayor, and we still collect non-perishable food items. People drop them off at the depot. Then Saturday afternoon is when we really roll up our sleeves and get to work, get everything sorted, and start to box the food items. Then on Sunday, starting at 11 o'clock, is when we actually start delivering the boxes. So we bring out the perishables. We've got frozen turkeys and ham, and we put those in the boxes, and we have people from everywhere come to help deliver. And what we do, though, is we just simply put the street address on there. We do not use names,
mm-hmm.
Because then that way people
it
feel a little bit more comfortable.
It gives them their privacy and dignity, even though they're receiving a gift. And I'm sure that is something that will stick with a person forever if they're part of the delivery of those items.
Yes. And we've had high school students that have helped it out. We've had seniors, citizens that have helped us out on those days. And it's really a very meaningful experience.
How many volunteers do you need to pull this whole weekend off?
We could use as many volunteers as we could get, especially on Sunday when we're actually out delivering, because 300 food boxes, 300 plus food boxes takes a little while. So we need people with vans or with SUVs or trucks that could take the boxes out. So we've had anywhere between 50 and 60 individuals helping us on Sunday.
Rich, this is an amazing story every year, and it's just better and better, and it's absolutely wonderful. I'm so glad you gave us a chance to learn a little bit more about it. And where can we find out information to volunteer? How can we reach out?
Well, they can do one of two things. They can either call Kathy Miller at City Hall, and that number is 630-552-8275, or they can contact me at the Chamber office at 630-552-7272.
All right, Rich Healy is our guest, and this is Rockin' Christmas. We're talking about a great way to start off your holiday season. Thank you, Rich, for being here on Fox Valley in Focus.
Well, thank you, Barb.
Mom! Mom!
What?
You can't find Ichabod.
What?
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. There are thousands of teens in foster care who would love to put up with you.
Lane Allen joins us now. Lane is the president of the Aurora Rotary Club, and they're the sponsors of Aurora's Festival of Lights. Lane, thanks for being here. Tell us all about it.
My pleasure. Well, it's hard to say where to start. I think kind of starting at the end, where we've got a month long from November 27th to December 27th, an opportunity for anybody to drive through Phillips Park, which is right near East High. And it's a beautiful park that was kind of underutilized for during the holidays. So we picked up this beautiful Festival of Lights 9 years ago. And it's a really beautiful display. We have about 70 large displays of LED caricatures, and some of them are required to be put up by a crane, and it's very festive, very well lit, and we light up about 100 trees, so we really take advantage of the park, and we've got about 70 or 100 snowflakes that are interspersed, and we really try to take the whole hill top that people get to see as they drive around this effectively a mile long ring road.
You were trying to describe this to me before the show, and I just can't imagine how a small club, a service club like your Rotary Club, even does this for a whole month. What that takes to maintain this, what that takes year round to make this happen. Tell us about this story.
Well, a good example of this is another city is looking at getting out of this effort, and so they're looking for someone to take over these displays. One Rotarian will say, oh, let's go get them. They get them, and then another Rotarian has to figure out how to maintain them, how to buy a trailer, and how to get them up and running. So there's a lot of different ways of being involved in this effort. Right now, we're going through the maintenance of them, and you can imagine, sorry to be out of sequence in all these, because it takes the whole year for us to put this together.
I'm sure it does. And how many people on the team? Is it everybody in the club?
Oh, no, there's effectively, in the maintenance of them, there's 5 to 10. And in fact, we take advantage of some of the township kids to come help. So these are teenagers, and once they get into routine, they understand we just got to twist the light bulb and check it, and in the maintenance. So we take advantage of other volunteers. Marmion kids are big and can help us put up the displays. Not-for-profits help us with bucket money or getting bucket money during the night of the events. And then our own Rotarians, take leadership roles to maintain them, logistics, buy trailers, work with the city closely, because this is we're the volunteer effort for the city of Aurora's Festival of Lights.
Lane,
so
this story.
It's very collaborative, I guess is the right word for it.
But Lane, this story gets better and better the more I hear about it, because I'm thinking of a wonderful experience for a family just driving through and seeing this holiday display. But when you talk about getting together, at first I was thinking about your fellow Rotarians just having a chance to rub elbows with each other and
yep,
work on a project.
That's exactly
but,
right.
But now you bring in the element of being role models and leaders for
right,
these young students.
Exactly.
And now you're talking about other service organizations. This is amazing. This
well,
is
and the Montgomery,
great story.
The new Montgomery Rotary Club is going to be putting up one of the displays, and they'll be getting some of the bucket money. We're trying to figure out how to evolve this event so that maybe actually we're looking for an organization that has quite a few kids who are over 18. So Waubonsie might be, you know, they, you know, if you have community hours that you want to put into, we need to develop a group. ROTC comes to mind as well. Kind of young leadership role kids that can start to every year take on a leadership role, because you know we've got it down, we figured it out, we've got all of the systems in place, but it does take time, mm-hmm. and it's very involved. But you're right, when it comes down to it, it's us interacting with families in their cars, giving them some holiday cheer, and as well as some candy canes. And it's a highlight of a lot of Aurora, Montgomery, you know, individuals. And you just had Rich Healy here talking about people looking for ways of getting through the holidays. This is, you know, just part of that is definitely holiday cheer is what it comes down to. And when you're interacting with people, it's, you know, it is very, you get a lot of value back when you're doing the exchange of the candy canes.
This is wonderful. Now, you told me it's going to be the end of November through December. What are the hours?
November 27th to December 27th, and it's from 5 to 9. And I think on Fridays and Saturdays it extended to 10.
Now, you mentioned bucket money. Does it cost, and how much does it cost to go in, and what is this bucket money?
It's donations.
Okay.
So, you know, sometimes we get $2, sometimes we get $5, sometimes we get $10, and, you know, sometimes we get a $20. And so we can get, on an average night, we get about 200 cars. On a very busy night, we get 400 cars. And then all of this is very carefully handled, and at the, this is our ninth year, so over 8 years we've received $250,000 that we've given back to the community. Because the maintenance issue is such a big issue, you know, although we're really looking for sponsors to help us with the maintenance costs, mm-hmm. The cost of the trailers, the storage costs, the city gives us free space, so it's really physical, changing out of lights, getting new displays. So there is some real cost, and we need sponsors to help us handle that cost. Mm-hmm. If we don't get enough sponsorship money, which this is a critical month for us on sponsorship,
then it has to come from the bucket money.
We really don't want to do that. But you know, it's a real project with real issues, and so it's a real balancing act in terms of pulling all of this off.
What a huge project to undertake. I think it's wonderful that your club has done this, and I'm so excited because I want to go to it and I want to see it. Tell us a little bit about the community efforts that you support with the bucket money.
We've got the Interfaith Food Pantry, East Aurora High School, West Aurora High School, Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, Quad County League, Aurora Township, Boys to Men, Hesed House, Wayside Cross, Aurora Public Library. Actually, I was the designer, my wife and I were the designers of the Children's Garden. So I donated those services, and then Aurora Rotary chipped in a significant amount for the Children's Garden. Mutual Ground, SciTech. So there's, you know, we're definitely looking at ways of enhancing our community and building our community in better ways.
This is fantastic. And when you think about the fact that the Aurora Festival of Lights is getting support from the city and free storage, it's getting support from all this volunteer effort, and that it comes down to light bulbs and physical things that are your expenses, everything else is donated. Lane, this is a fantastic thing you're doing for the community, and I want to thank you for being here.
So this is the Ring Road, and you come in off of next to East High, and it immediately starts up and comes around, and if you want to go around again, you can. So
really?
It's fun.
So as you can see from that map, there's a lot to see at the Festival of Lights. Lane, thank you so much for telling us all about it. I can't wait to see it.
Yeah, me too.
And we'll be right back right after this.
Everyone has friends. There's online friends. Friends to go out with on a Saturday night. Friends to hang out with and do nothing. Friends who show up on moving day And then there are the friends who'll be there if someone is dealing with a mental illness. Are you one of those friends?
Joining us now are Jessica and Ben Diven. They are going to be receiving funds from the Chili Chase that's coming up in Yorkville. That's a 5K run walk happening November 22nd, sponsored by the Knights of Columbus. Thanks for being here, Jessica and Ben. And Jessica, were you surprised by the offer to have this fundraiser for your family?
I was completely floored at the generosity of the Knights of Columbus in Yorkville. Completely unexpected and just honored.
I know that they've wanted to do something to help Ben for several years, and when the chance to sponsor the Chili Chase came around, they said, this is where the money's gonna go. So tell me a little bit about what you're hoping comes out of this fundraiser.
Well, again, we're so very thankful, and really, with raising a child with Duchenne, we have a lot of costs, a lot of medical costs, a lot of durable medical equipment costs. And our next step for Ben would be a full power chair, and we would also need an accessible van to go with that. So we've started saving, preparing, and this is just going to be a great help.
I have to ask Ben. Ben, how old are you?
9.
And where do you go to school?
Yorkville Intermediate School.
Okay, so you're 9 years old and you're going to school, and you take your chair with you wherever you go? Okay, I understand. I saw you whisking down the halls into the TV studio today, and you can go pretty fast in that thing.
Yes, I can.
You like it?
A lot.
Okay, but you're going to get a better chair someday.
I know that.
Okay, so tell me, what is Duchenne's?
Okay, Duchenne muscular dystrophy is a progressive muscle wasting disease. It affects all of the muscles of the body from, usually the first sign is weakness in the legs, and then upper body, and it also affects the heart and lungs because those are muscles as well.
And so this is a progressive disease?
Yes.
Now, you're looking for a power chair because you think someday he's going to need it?
Yes, we'll need a little more assistance at that time.
Okay, and you told me before the show that you're very careful to make sure that Ben gets his exercise, but not too much.
Yes, it's a very very fine balance between making sure that we use the muscle that we have, but that we don't overuse it, because if we overuse it, we damage it, and if we don't use it, we damage it as well. So it's a fine line to walk.
As a parent of a child with Duchenne's, this has really got to be something that overtakes your life, and I know you have other children as well.
It does. It was definitely because he wasn't diagnosed until the age of 4. It has been a pretty big lifestyle adjustment. His sisters are very helpful at times, right?
Yeah, sometimes.
And it has affected our whole family and just day-to-day life.
So when Ben was born, he was a normal, happy little boy, and you were, and it was, and he still is a normal, happy little boy. But as time went on, you've had to adjust and readjust and readjust throughout his life. You'll have to continue to do so.
We will. It's ongoing and changing. So we hit a plateau, and then we do a change, and we just adapt. We try to be as flexible as possible and take each day and everything as it comes.
So you're anticipating his needs, and you're looking at what you need to raise for money. You said a van that would be accessible to a wheelchair or have a lift on it, and then a special chair. How much money are we talking down the road?
Well, as far as the power chair, it can depend. I mean, just like you have different brands of cars, they range pretty much from $20,000 to $60,000 before insurance.
For the chair?
For the chair. And after that, at the same time, when you get a power chair, you also need to get transportation. So the car itself, again, depending on what kind you get, even though it has to be fully accessible with a ramp and make sure it fits the brand of wheelchair you have, that too is anywhere between $40,000 and $60,000.
Oh my goodness. And I know that being the person you are, and you're so outgoing and active in the community anyway, and then to have this extra project of all of Ben's needs, you know, being a mom is a project anyway, but the extra project of anticipating and getting ready for this, you've kind of become a spokesperson for Duchenne's and for also for children with disabilities all around.
Well, definitely with Duchenne, advocacy is best. We love it when people ask us questions and come directly out and acknowledge what's going on with us. And we're able to share our story and share what kids with rare disease go through.
But basically, kids are kids. And I have to ask you, so what are the things that you like doing, Ben?
I like playing drums. I play lots of video games.
Well, video games I get, but drums? You're a drummer? What kind of music do you like?
I don't know.
Just everything?
I guess so.
Yeah, your dad's a musician too, isn't he?
Yes.
So you get to play drums with him?
No. I don't want to actually.
And tell him, I'm up there, Dad. I want to play drums with you. That's good. That's good. And it's nice to see that he just likes having fun and being a kid and doing all the things that kids get to do. But you've traveled quite a bit with him too.
We have. For the past 4 years, we've been involved in a clinical drug study, and that has involved travel to Cincinnati Children's in Cincinnati, Ohio. Sometimes as frequently as once a week, we would be flown down there, and he went through a lot of testing. And we also go there as well for clinic visits twice a year.
This is an experimental drug. What are they trying to do?
It is. It's actually a drug that, and it's a long genetic lesson, so I'll try to keep it short, but it repairs the reading frame of his DNA by removing another part of his DNA. That's why he has Duchenne, because his dystrophin gene is incomplete. So he's missing exons. Of the 79 exons, he's missing number 48 through 50, and the reading frame can't be complete. So this drug goes in, it removes number 51 so that 47 and 52 fit together.
Wow. When you talk about going every week down to have take part of these trials and learn about this is way beyond me already, and probably most of us. But you told me that you're going to be appearing to talk about Duchenne's.
Yes, in November 24th, I'm going to be part of a group of parents that are addressing the FDA regarding this treatment, in hopes that it gets approval and will be available to all of the kids who need the drug.
It's fantastic. It really is fantastic. And I can't think of a better use of the money that's going to be raised at this Chili Chase 5K run walk. It's going to step off, I understand, at the Yorkville American Legion, right there on Route 34 in Yorkville. And it's going to end up at the Yorkville American Legion, a great locale for the event, and also travel through a really nice residential area of Yorkville on November 22nd. Will you be participating?
I will be, and hopefully Ben will as well, if we can find the right type of equipment to push him in. The chair's a little heavy to push, so. But I think so, we will be.
Okay, are you gonna be running or walking?
Running, of course.
Oh, so that's why you're looking, because I was thinking you could probably walk him down 5K, right?
We could, but Ben likes to go fast, right?
Okay, you looking forward to it? Okay, no idea how much money could be raised from this event. But every little bit is going to help.
Every little bit does.
And I know that in the past, this event, sponsored by the Yorkville Parks and Recreation Department, has had a variety of different beneficiaries for it. But I think it's wonderful it's going to go to Ben this year. This is really sweet.
We're very, very thankful.
Jessica Diven of Yorkville and her son Ben have been our guests on Fox Valley in Focus, and I just think this is a great way to start. We've talked about so many wonderful things today. Start your holiday season off on November 22nd with the Chili Chase 5K in Yorkville. Then you can travel on to Plano for Rockin' Christmas the first weekend in December, and remember that all through the entire month, you'll be able to enjoy Aurora's Festival of Lights. For Fox Valley Television, I'm Barbara Newman.